July 9th, Daily Video Bible Reading from the Net Bible, 2 Chronicles chapters 21 through 23 of the Old Testament. Jehoshaphat passed away and was buried with his ancestors in the city of David. His son Jehoram replaced him as king. His brothers, Jehoshaphat's sons, were Azariah, Jechiel, Zechariah, Azarihu, Michael, and Shephatiah. All of these were sons of King Jehoshaphat of Israel. Their father gave them many presents, including silver, gold, and other precious items, along with fortified cities in Judah. But he gave the kingdom to Jehoram because he was the firstborn. Jehoram took control of his father's kingdom and became powerful. Then he killed all his brothers, as well as some of the officials of Israel. Jehoram was 32 years old when he became king, and he reigned for 8 years in Jerusalem. He followed in the footsteps of the kings of Israel, just as Ahab's dynasty had done, for he married Ahab's daughter. He did evil in the sight of the Lord. But the Lord was unwilling to destroy David's dynasty because of the promise he had made to give David a perpetual dynasty. During Jehoram's reign, Edom freed themselves from Judah's control and set up their own king. Jehoram crossed over to Zair with his officers and all his chariots. The Edomites, who had surrounded him, attacked at night and defeated him and his chariot officers. So Edom had remained free from Judah's control to this very day. At that same time, Libnah also rebelled and freed themselves from Judah's control because Jehoram rejected the Lord God of his ancestors. He also built high places on the hills of Judah. He encouraged the residents of Jerusalem to be unfaithful to the Lord and led Judah away from the Lord. Jehoram received this letter from Elijah, the prophet. This is what the Lord God of your ancestor, David, says. You have not followed in the footsteps of your father, Jehoshaphat, and of King Asa of Judah, but have instead followed in the footsteps of the kings of Israel. You encouraged the people of Judah and the residents of Jerusalem to be unfaithful to the Lord, just as the family of Ahab does in Israel. You also killed your brothers, members of your father's family who were better than you. So look, the Lord is about to severely afflict your people, your sons, your wives, and all you own. And you will get a serious, chronic intestinal disease which will cause your intestines to come out. The Lord stirred up against Jehoram the Philistines and the Arabs who lived beside the Cushites. They attacked Judah and swept through it. They carried off everything they found in the royal palace, including his sons and wives. None of his sons was left, except for his youngest, Ahaziah. After all this happened, the Lord afflicted him with an incurable intestinal disease. After about 2 years, his intestines came out because of the disease, so that he died a very painful death. His people did not make a bonfire to honor him, as they had done for his ancestors. Jehoram was 32 years old when he became king, and he reigned 8 years in Jerusalem. No one regretted his death. He was buried in the city of David, but not in the royal tombs. The residents of Jerusalem made his youngest son, Ahaziah, king in his place, for the raiding party that invaded the city with the Arabs had killed all the older sons. So Ahaziah, son of Jehoram, became king of Judah. Ahaziah was 22 years old when he became king, and he reigned for 1 year in Jerusalem. His mother was Athaliah, the granddaughter of Omri. He followed in the footsteps of Ahab's dynasty, for his mother gave him evil advice. He did evil in the sight of the Lord like Ahab's dynasty, because after his father's death, they gave him advice that led to his destruction. He followed their advice and joined Ahab's son King Joram of Israel in a battle against King Hazael of Syria at Ramoth-Gilead, in which the Syrians defeated Joram. Joram returned to Jezreel to recover from the wounds he received from the Syrians in Ramah when he fought against King Hazael of Syria. Ahaziah, son of King Jehoram of Judah, went down to visit Joram, son of Ahab, in Jezreel, because he had been wounded. God brought about Ahaziah's downfall through his visit to Joram. When Ahaziah arrived, he went out with Joram to meet Jehu, son of Nimshi, whom the Lord had commissioned to wipe out Ahab's family. When Jehu was dishing out punishment to Ahab's family, he discovered the officials of Judah and the sons of Ahaziah's relatives who were serving Ahaziah and killed them. He looked for Ahaziah, who was captured while hiding in Samaria. They brought him to Jehu and then executed him. They did give him a burial, for they reasoned, "He is the son of Jehoshaphat, who sought the Lord with his whole heart." There was no one in Ahaziah's family strong enough to rule in his place. When Athaliah, the mother of Ahaziah, saw that her son was dead, she was determined to destroy the entire royal line of Judah. So Jehoshabeath, the daughter of King Jehoram, took Ahaziah's son Joash and sneaked him away from the rest of the royal descendants who were to be executed. She hid him and his nurse in the room where the bed covers were stored. So Jehoshabeath, the daughter of King Jehoram, wife of Jehoiada the priest, and sister of Ahaziah, hid him from Athaliah so she could not execute him. He remained in hiding in God's temple for 6 years, while Athaliah was ruling over the land. In the 7th year, Jehoiada made a bold move. He made a pact with the officers of the units of hundreds, Azariah, son of Jehoram, Ishmael, son of Jehochan, Azariah, son of Obed, Maaseiah, son of Adiah, and Elishaphat, son of Zichri. They traveled throughout Judah and assembled the Levites from all the cities of Judah, as well as the Israelite family leaders. They came to Jerusalem, and the whole assembly made a covenant with the king in the temple of God. Jehoiada said to them, "The king's son will rule, just as the Lord promised David's descendants. This is what you must do. 1/3 of you priests and Levites who are on duty during the Sabbath will guard the doors. Another 1/3 of you will be stationed at the royal palace, and still another 1/3 at the foundation gate. All the others will stand in the courtyards of the Lord's temple. No one must enter the Lord's temple except the priests and Levites who are on duty. They may enter because they are ceremonially pure. All the others should carry out their assigned service to the Lord. The Levites must surround the king. Each of you must hold his weapon in his hand. Whoever tries to enter the temple must be killed. You must accompany the king wherever he goes." The Levites and all the men of Judah did just as Jehoiada the priest ordered. Each of them took his men, those who were on duty during the Sabbath, as well as those who were off duty on the Sabbath. Jehoiada the priest did not release his divisions from their duties. Jehoiada the priest gave to the officers of the units of hundreds King David's spears and shields that were kept in God's temple. He placed the men at their post, each holding his weapon in his hand. They lined up from the south side of the temple to the north side and stood near the altar in the temple, surrounding the king. Jehoiada and his sons led out the king's son and placed on him the crown and the royal insignia. They proclaimed him king and poured olive oil on his head. They declared, "Long live the king!" When Athaliah heard the royal guard shouting and praising the king, she joined the crowd at the Lord's temple. Then she saw the king standing by his pillar at the entrance. The officers and trumpeters stood beside the king, and all the people of the land were celebrating and blowing trumpets, and the musicians with various instruments were leading the celebration. Athaliah tore her clothes and yelled, "Treason! Treason!" Jehoiada the priest sent out the officers of the units of hundreds who were in charge of the army and ordered them, "Bring her outside the temple to the guards. Put the sword to anyone who follows her." The priest gave this order because he had decided she should not be executed in the Lord's temple. They seized her and took her into the precincts of the royal palace through the horse's entrance. There, they executed her. Jehoiada then drew up a covenant stipulating that he, all the people, and the king should be loyal to the Lord. All the people went and demolished the temple of Baal. They smashed its altars and idols. They killed Matan, the priest of Baal, in front of the altars. Jehoiada then assigned the duties of the Lord's temple to the priest, the Levites whom David had assigned to the Lord's temple. They were responsible for offering burnt sacrifices to the Lord with joy and music, according to the law of Moses and the edict of David. He posted guards at the gates of the Lord's temple, so no one who was ceremonially unclean in any way could enter. He summoned the officers of the units of hundreds, the nobles, the rulers of the people, and all the people of land, and he then led the king down from the Lord's temple. They entered the royal palace through the upper gate and seated the king on the royal throne. All the people of the land celebrated, for the city had rest now that they had killed Athaliah. God, I find it so fascinating reading about Athaliah. She was never recognized as actually a ruling member, but she did rule for 7 years. Not really sure all the history that happened in there. Plus, it's a little bit odd to have a female as a ruling king or queen. It's not that it didn't happen, it was just a little bit odd. So Athaliah fascinates me. She was so incredibly evil, and yet she was allowed to be on the throne in the royal palace for 7 years, making evil decisions against you. And I think this is incredibly notable because at any given time, you had the power to take her off that throne. I think this is something we really need to get, God. You had the power and control and sovereignty of the situation to stop it, but you didn't. You chose to let her rule for going on 7 years. Something happened, and Jehoiada, in that 7th year, said, I'm going to do something. It's just incredible to me to watch you help change and guide and focus your people, because Jehoiada didn't just make a decision. That's not what the Bible says. It says he made a bold move. And how many opportunities have you given each of us to make bold moves in your plan for this world? And how many of us haven't made those? How many of us have said, as Jehoiada could have said, I'm good. You know, Athaliah's kind of horrid. She's destroying a lot of people. She's taking a lot of people away from God, but it's going to be a mess to get her off the throne. And I'm older, you know, I don't have that much longer to deal with this. Or it could be something that we're dealing with that's a little bit more realistic. Oh, I know my brother in Christ is sinning, but if I confront him, he'll make a big deal of it, and I don't want him to be mad at me, and I don't want him to go around the church telling other people that I was a busybody, and so maybe I'm just better off just not helping him with it, acknowledging that he has that sin issue. I'll just be over here, and he and God can figure it out. That's not what you teach us in the Bible. That's not why we're here on earth. If we were here on earth just so you could manipulate and control us like puppets, there's kind of no point at all to any of this. But you have that control. You had that ability to take Athaliah off of the throne. And instead, you were working with Jehoiada. And Jehoiada listened. Thank goodness, because he's a priest. Jehoiada listened. And he made a bold move. He believed in you. He knew how you acted. He knew what you expected. He knew how important the Davidic line was. And his brave wife, his also brave wife, had already hid Joash, the real king who should have been on the throne. And Joash at this point would have just been turning 7. So it's not like they even had somebody who was an adult they could put on the throne. Another bold move by Jehoiada. So we're going to put a 7-year-old on the throne. It's not like it hadn't been done before, but we're going to do it. This is really important for us to understand, God. We aren't bystanders in this world. We aren't puppets that you manipulate. You allow us to choose situations. Some people call it free will. You allow us to choose situations, and you're there helping us, guiding us, giving us strength and empowerment if we choose to go that path. Thank goodness Jehoiada chose that path. But it is only with your strength, your power, your almightiness, your grace, your mercy, that we're even able to make those wise decisions or bold moves, as it talks about with Jehoiada and also with his wife. God, I just pray that the next time one of those opportunities comes into our lives where things are a little bit uncomfortable or could get really uncomfortable if I say something, that you just hold my heart accountable. And I also hold on to the strength that you have chosen to give me, that you've promised me, along with the desire to please you. That if I go to my fellow brother or sister in Christ and say, we need to talk. And I know you might be angry initially, but we need to talk because I love you enough to say this to you. I love you enough to say this to you because God first loved me. This isn't a self-righteous statement. This isn't I'm better than you statement. This is I love you enough to want to stop this. Even making a bold move like that in the face of possibly losing a friendship, a relationship, and having someone be mad at you. God, thank you for that strength and for empowering us to make bold moves in this world. In your son's name I pray. Amen.